you very much. This talk is about bit security of certain elliptic curve based one-way function, and it's a joint work with Alexander Duke. First, to introduce the problem, very often, whenever we have a secret, a long secret, we are interested to know whether parts of this secret is secure, so that we can use only certain bits of the secret. In particular, one question is whether we can use individual bits as hard-to-compute bits. And the main sort of one-way function for which, on which I want to focus, it's a hardness assumption known as the fixed argument pairing inversion problem, or FAPI, and it's the underlying assumption of various protocols. So just to state the assumption first, I'm going to fix a prime, P, and an elliptic curve over FP, and then I will consider a large cyclic subgroup of points on the elliptic curve, G, and I will consider a cryptographic pairing from G cross G into a target group. So if I fix one of the arguments of the pairing, the second argument, what one gets is a function from the group G to the target group. So that's the function that we often believe is hard to invert. And the problem of inverting this function, we call it the fixed argument pairing inversion 2 problem. So if I fix the first argument, then I'm getting the problem that's known as FAPI 1. Okay, so why is this problem relevant and interesting? Well, we can just mention a few schemes that are whose security is based on this assumption. So the celebrated identity-based encryption scheme of Bonnet and Franklin. Then we have the three-party one-round key agreement protocol by Zhu that's based on this assumption, and we have also signature schemes, identity-based signature schemes due to Hess. So basically, the assumption that we want to make is that FAPI 2 is hard. And why is this assumption valid? If you believe that FAPI 1 and FAPI 2 are simultaneously hard, then this, well, if you can solve FAPI 1 and FAPI 2, then this yields a solution to the computational Diffie-Hellman assumption. So it is reasonable to believe that FAPI 2, at least for the moment, is hard. And this is what we are going to do in this talk. So the contribution that I will report on today is assuming the hardness of this problem, FAPI 2, then we can show that all the bits of the input to the pairing-based one-way function that we just defined are secure, so any of the bits. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about the model of analyzing this this problem. First of all, elliptic curves for us will be given by short Weierstrass equations, y squared equals x cubed plus ax plus b, with non-zero discriminant. Of course, some of these equations will be isomorphic, so we need to distinguish isomorphic equations. And the way in which we would distinguish, it's very classical how you would distinguish two isomorphic equations. Basically, their coefficients have to be related via a scalar lambda in the way that a prime is equal to lambda to the minus 4 times a, and b prime is lambda to the minus 6 times b. So there should exist a lambda. So the two equations are going to be isomorphic if and only if there is a lambda that relates the two coefficients in this way. So, and we can also write down the isomorphism explicitly between the two curves just by multiplying the x and the y coordinates by lambda square and lambda cube, respectively. So now it's very easy to see from here that each isomorphism class will have precisely p minus 1 short Weierstrass equations, namely that will be determined by the number of scalars lambda that we have in the multiplicative group of the finite field. So what we would assume, and the way we would state the main result is as follows. So we would assume that we have an oracle that predicts the kth bit of the input to the one-way function on a significant fraction of all the wire stress equations in the isomorphism class. So here I should make it very precise that when we talk about bits of an element in a finite field or in a group, we usually specify the explicit representation of the finite field. Here we talk about bits of a point on an elliptic curve. So we need to specify exactly the short wire stress equation that represents this elliptic curve. That's why we are assuming that the oracle works on a significant fraction of all the wire stress equations representing the elliptic curve. So we can query the oracle with the output of the one-way function together with specifying the short wire stress equation. So basically, we show that if we have such an oracle, then we have an efficient algorithm to invert the function fq. Okay, and as a conclusion, this shows that if we believe that FAPI2 is hard, then all the bits of the input to the pairing-based one-way function are going to be hard to compute. Okay, so just to mention a generalization of that, so the argument that we are using uses very little from the properties of the pairings. So in fact, all we are using is that the one-way function is defined on the isomorphism class. And that's why we can state a much more general result here. So assuming that we have a one-way function, assuming that we have a function from the elliptic curve group to the target group with the property that its definition is independent of the choice of the short wire stress equation, so that it's defined on the isomorphism class, then if inverting f is hard, we get that every bit to the input of f is secure. Well, here is an open question that is currently the only cryptographically interesting example of such a function is the pairing-based one-way function. It would be very interesting if we can find other examples to which the above result could apply. So let me see a little bit about the method used to prove the security result. So our method is based on defining a special code. So we would use the oracle to transform the problem of inverting the function to a least decoding problem, so coding theory problem. So we would define a special code, which we call the elliptic curve multiplication code, ECMC, whose code words will be in bijection with the points on the elliptic on the group that are the input points to the function. And then we would use the oracle to construct a noisy code word corresponding to the hidden point. And then we would, inverting the function would basically mean least decoding. So the least decoding part is based on Fourier transforms. Technique that's known as the least decoding via Fourier transform, and it's due to multiple people. So the code words, the idea is that the code words in our case will be viewed as functions on the multiplicative group of the finite field. Then the first step of the algorithm will be taking this function and doing a Fourier transform and picking only the heavy Fourier coefficients. Of course, we cannot do this always because the function is defined on an exponentially large domain. So what we need as a requirement is that the number of heavy Fourier coefficients is small. And if such a requirement is, if we assume such a requirement, then we can apply an algorithm that's due to Kavya, Goldwasser, and Safra. Which is known as the SFT algorithm, that will give us a list, a polynomial-sized list, of all the heavy Fourier coefficients. I will comment a little bit about this on that later. And finally, once we have this list of coefficients, for each of the heavy Fourier coefficients, we are going to try to list all the code words that have this coefficient as heavy. So given a frequency, basically, on the frequency domain, we are going to list all the code words that have this frequency, that have a significant Fourier coefficient at this frequency. So this is what we call the recoverability part of the algorithm. Now, let me comment a little bit on how we could use the prediction oracle. So if we are given the hidden input R on the group, and if we are given a short wire stress equation W, then one thing we could do is we could use the prediction oracle B, plugging in the short wire stress equation together with the output to get the kth bit of the x coordinate of R of the point R on W. So using that, we can define a code word. So that will be a function from the multiplicative group to plus or minus one as follows. At each coordinate, I'm going to change the Weierstrass equation W lambda with the isomorphic one obtained by lambda, and then query the oracle on that equation. So this gives me a code word. I can't really represent it efficiently because the domain is exponentially large, but at least I can access it. I can access every bit of this code word. Okay, now, and it's a noisy code word because my oracle is noisy. Now, I have to construct the code, and the most natural definition of the code is simply to take the x coordinate of the representation of the point on the corresponding Weierstrass equation. So in other words, I have to multiply by this factor of lambda square here. Well, that doesn't really, so first of all, we need to see how we can decode, what kind of properties are needed. And as I kind of implicitly mentioned already, we need three properties that I list here. First of all, accessibility, so any bit of the input, any bit of the noisy code word has to be accessible. Then the second property is Fourier concentration, and then the third property is recoverability. So unfortunately, with this definition, the Fourier concentration, one cannot establish the Fourier concentration. So let me tell you a little bit about the Fourier concentration. Very simple background on Fourier analysis. If we have a function, then after doing a Fourier transform, we're getting a set of frequencies, and each of these frequencies comes with a coefficient. So we call the function Fourier concentrated if it has a small number of significant Fourier coefficients. So if we have only a small number of these frequencies that would approximate sufficiently well the function. So the frequencies, we call them Fourier bases. Well, they form a Fourier basis. And in our case, since we are working discretely, those will be characters of the group. So the second point is recoverability. So recoverability, once we have a list of the significant Fourier coefficients and the corresponding frequencies, for each frequency, we would like to obtain a list of all the code words that are having this frequency is significant. So the recoverability, once we have Fourier concentration plus recoverability, that typically implies list decoding. So let's look at the first attempt a little bit more closely. So we have these code words that are defined here using multiplication by lambda square, or taking the x coordinate on the corresponding Weierstrass equation. This will work fine if we can show that the code words are Fourier concentrated. However, establishing such a result is very difficult. Because if you do the Fourier transform, then the Fourier transform, the Fourier coefficients, are estimated using very famous Gauss sums in analytic number theory. And this has been very well studied by the analytic number theory people. And basically, one cannot get any good estimates on to show the result of the type that we need. So this approach seems to be not so fruitful, and we need a different approach. Basically, what we would do is we would define a different list decoding problem. And here, to modify the list decoding problem, we use an idea that's due to Bonnet and Sperlinski from 2001. When they studied the bit security of the least significant bit of the Diffie-Hellman function. So the idea is that we would modify our prediction oracle by taking a square root whenever possible of the of the position lambda of the element lambda in the multiplicative group of the finite field via a random square root function. So if one does this, one is slightly randomizing the prediction oracle, and that allows for linearization in the code. So our code now will look like multiplication by lambda as opposed to multiplication by lambda square. And here we can do very precise estimates on the Fourier coefficients and prove Fourier concentration. So this code is Fourier concentrated, and one can also show that it is recoverable. So this uses a nice technique of Morillo and Raffles on a representation, convenient representation of the interval from 0 to p minus 1. So as a summary, just to summarize the results, we prove that every bit to the input of any elliptic curve-based one-way function is hard to compute. In particular, the input bits to the fixed argument pairing-based one-way functions are going to be hard to compute. And here we also list several open questions. So, of course, the most difficult problem here, which is kind of out of hope for the moment, is can you prove the same result if you fix the short Weierstrass equation, if you assume only an oracle that gives you the bit prediction on a fixed Weierstrass equation. Another generalization here is to look at the entire class of curves with a given number of points, which is relevant for the choice of elliptic curves in cryptography, and then show that if you have an imperfect oracle working on this class, then you can again invert the input to the pairing-based function. So we have done some progress on that question. And finally, we are interested in assuming that prediction oracle that predicts a block of bits. So this is also possible with the Fourier transform ideas. Thank you very much.